Good afternoon. Welcome to St. Joseph's on this first weekend of autumn as we offer our praise and worship to God together once again. Leading us in prayer is Father Jim. My name is Ron Nagy. Joining us at Mass today are Charles and Patty Warwick, who are celebrating their 25th wedding anniversary. Today we celebrate Priesthood Sunday with gratitude for our priests here at St. Joseph Parish and pray for priests everywhere that God will grant them perseverance in their calling. This weekend is our annual volunteer ministry fair and small group sign-up event. Together we ponder the gifts and talents that God has given us and consider how we might share these as servants of the good news. What price are we willing to pay to become true disciples and followers of Jesus? Today's gospel challenges us with the cost of belonging to him. As we begin our worship, let us raise our voices in praise of God with the hymn, All Are Welcome. But first, let us stand and greet one another as brothers and sisters in the Lord.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good morning.
We gather and pray in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
And also I add my congratulations to Charles and Patty, Patricia, Warwick, for their 25 years of love together. That brings forth family and moves them along in that journey. For us, in our part, we're in the 26 weeks. We're moving along, too. You know, the 26 weeks as a little bit further along on this journey of the liturgical year. And so we're mindful that as we walk with the Lord through the Gospel of Mark, of how we can learn and grow. Our Lord Jesus Christ takes a special moment to teach his apostles, to call them to a higher level of behavior and morality in their journeys. For the times that we have failed to live up to the calling that has been given to us to be the best that we can possibly be, we take a few moments now to ask forgiveness for our sins.
Lord Jesus, you came to call the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You intercede for us with the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thanks for your great glory.
Let us pray. O God, who manifest your almighty power above all by pardoning and showing us mercy, bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us and make those hastening to attain your promises heirs to the treasures of heaven. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Numbers. The Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to Moses. Taking some of the spirit that was on Moses, the Lord bestowed it on the 70 elders, and as the spirit came to rest on them, they prophesied. Now two men, one named Eldad and the other Medad, were not in the gathering, but had been left in the camp. They too had been on the list, but had not gone out to the tent. Yet the spirit came to rest on them also, and they prophesied in the camp. So when a young man quickly told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp," Joshua, son of Nun, who from his youth had been Moses' aide, said, "Moses, my lord, stop them." But Moses answered him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the people of the Lord were prophets. Would that the Lord might bestow his spirit on them all." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The precepts of the Lord give joy to the fear of the Lord is
A reading from the letter of St. James. Come now, you rich, weep and wail over your impending miseries. Your wealth has rotted away. Your clothes have become moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded. Then that corrosion will be a testimony against you. It will devour your flesh like a fire. You have stored up treasure for the last days. Behold, the wages you withheld from the workers who harvested your fields are crying aloud, and the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on earth in luxury and pleasure. You have fattened your hearts for the day of slaughter. You have condemned. You have murdered the righteous one. He offers you no resistance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. At that time, John said to Jesus, Teacher, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we tried to prevent him because he does not follow us. Jesus replied, Do not prevent him. There was no one who performs a mighty deed in my name who can at the same time speak ill of me. For whoever is not against us is for us. Anyone who gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ, amen, I say to you, will surely not lose his reward. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were put around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed than with two hands to go into Gehenna, into the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life crippled than with two feet to be thrown into Gehenna. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. Better for you to enter into the kingdom of heaven with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into Gehenna, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Every 4 years when we move into the election year, we see the dynamics of our culture and the relationships that we have and the divisions that are getting more and more pronounced. And it's striking. You know, we can learn a lot from these readings that are intended for all of us because in a way, these simple dynamics that are illustrated here in the scriptures today, they kind of get out of control when we move into the larger sphere of our culture and society, especially as it's really pronounced now. We have many forms of media, and they just all seem to magnify the divisions that are there in the culture. But I use that just to recognize that's a reality. But it's also for us that we can fall into some of those tendencies. Certainly, divisions and hostility that we see in the culture is kind of a situation that has run out of control. It's the off the rails in terms of behavior, and we can't change that. A lot of times, people get frustrated and they get caught up in it, and it's like, well, don't believe that you can change that. The world is under the dominion of the evil one, and obviously that sense of division is something very much the fruit of his activity. We can't do that. We can't put that on precious. We remember the wisdom of Mother Teresa, who when asked about her work in Calcutta and someone kind of was setting her up in terms of a question, it's like, here you've done so much work, but it doesn't appear you've had any influence on the poverty in Calcutta. And her response was very calm. I was called by the Lord to be faithful, not successful. So that's what we're called. We're called to be people who are our unifiers, people who are our people who have that disposition of Mother Teresa, calmness in the midst of difficulties of our world. So with that in mind, we want to go a little bit deeper into what we're seeing in these readings here today. The book of Numbers, that awesome book of Numbers that you see Moses dealing with this problem. And where it stems from, Eldad and Medad are not part of the major group. They were on the list, but they didn't show up at the meeting tent where the Lord would have his manifestation coming down upon Moses. And it was usually a moment for the Jewish people of great spiritual benefit, as it was this day, the Spirit of the Lord being poured out, not just on Moses, but upon those who had been selected, the 70. And Eldad and Medad, who didn't go, for whatever reason, they didn't make it there, but they also had this pouring out of the Spirit. And it caused a rift. It caused some people to start measuring and to start saying, hey, they're not part of our group. They didn't go through what I had to do to get the Spirit a part of me. I'm part of the sanctioned element of this ministry and leadership that is there. These two guys aren't. So the complaint works its way to Joshua. Joshua then takes it to Moses. And Moses gives that very eloquent response. Are you jealous that the Lord of God is super abundant? And then Moses gives the right teaching on that our Lord affirms as well, is that the flow of the Spirit of God is a good thing. When it's authentic, good, and true, it has to be healthy. It has to be measured by that effect. Even in the gospel that is closely related, you see this person who's out there who is casting out demons in the name of Jesus. John and some of the other apostles, we don't know which ones, but John, they take umbrage over this reality. And Jesus recognizes this moment as being very similar to what Moses had with Joshua. And we know that in Moses and Joshua, that Joshua was under a kind of a program of formation. Moses is getting older. The 40 years in the desert took its toll. He had to have someone who was going to move into his position. That was Joshua. So in this moment that we hear of Joshua and Moses being together, there is a great sense of formation that is there. And Joshua, as we know, took on that role beautifully. He led the people into the Holy Lands with the favor of the Lord being with him as he did so. And Jesus is very much aware of that as he manages his disciples, because it starts off with a simple teaching. If a person's doing these great deeds in my name, he's going to be favorable to me. If he's not against us, he's going to be for us. When he's in the midst of such positive activity like that, then Jesus goes into a deeper teaching. He kind of changes channels a little bit the way he's approaching it, and he talks about the little ones or anyone who brings scandal to the little ones. What's going on with that teaching? And that's where it really can speak to us who are here. And certainly the wider church, we have a hierarchical church, so obviously we can see the bishops in the role of the apostles. Jesus is calling the highest levels of leadership in the life of his future church, that they have to have a high bar and standard for themselves. That those who are under them are received with great dignity and are cherished in who they are, as opposed to where he says elsewhere that you can't be like the world, lording your authority over them. And we see that a lot in the world. We see that in corporations. Sometimes it's healthy. Sometimes it's good, the way that things are set up. Sometimes not so much. And we can't be that way. If that's the flaw, then, cut off your hand, gouge out your eye, change, make a real change. And see, that dynamic, I like to think of that dynamic as taking place, obviously, for the bishops. You don't have that high bar. But anyone who has spiritual relationship to another, pastors in their parishes. I have to hear these words with a certain attentiveness that goes above and beyond, you know, those coming to participate and enhance their faith through living out your Catholic experience, coming on a regular basis, forming and letting the grace transform you. I have to take that stewardship I have of the care of souls, St. John Vianney, you know, this care of souls, I have to take that very seriously. And so that's my challenge. And so I have to hear these words. Yeah, the little ones. Because the little ones, I did a little bit of reading. I had a chance to be with our OCIA this week doing some teaching on Wednesday. And I got a chance to hear them commenting. They were led by their director, Susan Kowalski, about, you know, who are the little ones in the reading? And they're fantastic. These a lot of young people across the spectrum in age, but the understanding they had as they took apart this reading was beautiful. As they really poured their heart and minds out to it. The little ones, you know, by most scholarship, would be those who are kind of joining the mission, but are still have an innocence about them. The apostles are that first echelon of leadership. They're going to have people under them, and they better cherish that role of responsibility of formation. The way that we try to do as a parish when we do bring new people into the life of the church. We are doing it this weekend as we have our ministry fair, you know, where we invite volunteers to come forward. We had a wonderful turnout of those stepping forward for religious education. That's the little ones that were here stepping into ministry, embracing and advancing their faith in simple ways. And all the ways that we have ministry in the life of the parish is an important element of that. And to rejoice that you are in the favor of the Lord. And so we work together as a family to kind of make that happen. And what are some of the dynamics, of course, that can happen whenever you enter into ministry? Is that you can start to have a competition that can happen from one group to the next. Talking with someone about C.S. Lewis, one of my favorite little works that he did is the Screwtape Letters. And he talks about that dynamic, you know, in the church, this new convert to the Christian, one of the Christian churches, is like he's entering in, and one supervisor devil is writing to a minion devil to kind of thwart him. And he says, don't bother trying to stop him from going to church, but get him into the church and make him turn whatever group he is in to the only group that's important to him. So he only sees whatever he has in terms of his Christian perspective from that little point. And he says, then you'll make a Pharisee and he'll be ours. As one devil speaking to another devil. You see that? And that's kind of like the same dynamic that's going on here. If some of these envy and a certain sense of defensive and protective, this protective shell that's put around, no, this is our ministry. He didn't do what I had to do, so he can't be a part of that. She can't be a part of that ministry because of this reality of what I experienced, and so therefore they can't have it. That's kind of childish in its style. We can do that in many ways. It's not just in the church. It can happen in families. You know, when we see different sense of treatment, it's like, oh, you know, this person, they're getting all the breaks in the family, the favored son of the family. It's so frustrating. I'm the one who did all the hard work. We can allow that to kind of corrupt the role that we have, which is called to be a very generous role, a role that just is pleased to see God's life unfold. And however it unfolds, it's a joy for us. And so that's something that we can find also in the second reading. We've been following the letter of James for quite a while, as we're moving through this letter. And we see a lot in James's letter of how it has a kind of a moral tone. It's a moral guidebook, a manual of how to live morally as responsible as in a way as we possibly can. Last week, matter of fact, one of the two elements that was this jealousy and friction, you know, that don't let these things enter into your lives, which actually fit well with the readings here today. Today, we have a sense of comfort and luxury and getting attached to things. Looking for something that just reinforces who you are, your position, and your comfort in life. Now that's something that, again, we can see as a dynamic in the world. I think a driving force that we have of so much of the way power is manifested and exercised in the secular world around us is like to get the authority, get the power so that I can protect my position and comfort, advance my luxury in the world. That's kind of what's being said in James. I can happen in the life of the church too. I mean, you can see the pastor who looks for the sweet assignment, so he's all set for the rest of his career. I mean, you can get that mentality that can go in there. The bishop who's just kind of looking for the trappings of being the bishop without a sense and a heart for service and ministry. If you fall into that trap, you're falling into the pitfalls that are being described in the readings here today. We're not taking on the role to be the person who is taking care of the others. And having that very sincere and almost dramatic, you know, the language of the over-the-top language of cutting off your hand, gouging out your eye. In other words, be serious about the role of forming the innocent one, the little ones in your midst. And so that's what we strive to do. In our Mass, we may mention the beginning, at the end there's an announcement, you know, taking on that sense of ministry. So I love one of the aspects of St. Joseph's. We do have a really healthy sense of participation in the many different groups. We have groups that are part of ministries within the life of the church, the liturgies that we have. And then also at St. Joe's, we have oodles of different groups that are connected, from the KSC, the talking to a gospel life person coming along, that do membership. And so they look for members, St. Vincent Paul Society, they look for members. And we also have an incredible level of volunteering in those areas too, which are groups that are attached to the life of the parish. All these things are a part of living that out. And so when you see and you hear these readings and you see these dynamics kind of unfolding, it's always a great joy to know I'm a part of that. I'm the one that Jesus is referring to at this particular moment about being the little one. And when we do find ourselves in that position, it advances us to move along in the ways of the kingdom of God, to rejoice in those moments, and to build on a true joy, a deep joy that's going to sustain us. Because you never know when the challenge will come along the way where all of a sudden we find ourselves to be in the Eldad or Medad position, and people say, what are you doing? You know, I mean, anyone who's in that position, you want to say, well, I'm sorry, I'm going to back off. Rather than recognize, it's like, well, I stand here with the ways of the Lord. I stand here as a humble prophet like Amos in the Old Testament. I stand here because I know God's working in my life. That's why I'm here. And for us as a people of God, you know, coming to church, forming and shaping ourselves, getting comfortable and confident in that idea of how the Lord is working in your lives, whether it be as a family, you know, 25 years of marriage, bringing forth a life to our community, that might be the way, or taking on a ministry like we encourage so many people to do here at St. Joe's. All these different ways are us living out in a real time, in a real way, the discipleship that we are called to be for our Lord Jesus Christ. We rise, my brothers and sisters, mindful of the formation we receive in the liturgy and life of the church. We turn to the creed here in the middle of the Mass, and we now take a moment to pray. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible.
I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven.
By the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary
and became man.
For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets.
I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now, with confidence, we bring forth these prayers and petitions.
Let us pray for the church. Help us grow in virtue, O God. Cleanse us from our faults and help us to serve you with blameless hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the world and all its people. God of every land and nation, we beg you to guide civil leaders in the ways of peaceful cooperation. Bless the work of peacemakers around the globe. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the poor. May we put our faith into action, O God, and reach out to those who have nothing to wear or no food for the day. Bless the work of our St. Vincent de Paul Society and all those who serve the poor. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray that we become good stewards of the gifts entrusted to us. God of all blessings, enable each of us to invest ourselves in sharing our gifts and talents. Help us to see your image in the face of all those who we serve. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those who endure sickness in mind or body. God, heal those who cry out to you for help, especially Christina Rodriguez, Donnie Goforth, Rosemary Dombrowski, and all those, Kathy Waligorski, and all those in need of our prayers. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us remember the dead. May our beloved dead enter the kingdom that endures forever. We pray especially for Bonnie Bailey, Mario Moroni, Monica Cote, Elise Francis Sobchak, and Salvador Palero. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Now let us pray for our personal needs in a moment of silence. On this Priesthood Sunday, O Lord, bless all the men and women you have called to religious life. May the peace of Christ guard their hearts and minds as they proclaim the good news of salvation to his people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, receive these, our prayers and petitions, through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you forever and ever.
Amen.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands
for the praise and glory of his name,
for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Grant us, O merciful God, that this, our offering, may find acceptance with you, and that through it the wellspring of all blessing may be laid open before us through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our very being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Holy Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so, Lord, with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we now acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to the glory of your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts that we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night Jesus was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks and praise, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, O Lord, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim,
by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles, glorious martyrs, and all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased, O Lord, to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church here on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Alan Vigneron, Archbishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Heavenly Father, listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. And in your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. For there too we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Now rise, my brothers and sisters, and at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, O Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days. By the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "My peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not upon our sins, but upon the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer one another a sign of Christ's peace. Peace be with you, Father. Peace be with you. Hey, guys. Peace, guys.
Behold, my brothers and sisters, behold the Lamb of God, he who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room.
Only say the word.
Thank you. Let us pray. May this heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body that we may be co-heirs in glory with Christ, to whose suffering we are united. Whenever we proclaim his death, he who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the announcements. Please see the voice for our website for details about the Right to Life Life Chain, which will be held next Sunday afternoon from 1:30 p.m. until 3 p.m. right here along Lapeer Road, M24, in front of the church. Signs will be provided. For those who aren't familiar, you hold a sign in support of life and you just pray. And it's a kind of a silent witness and a reminder of the dignity of life of those babies who have no voice yet in this world. And then also we have the Blessing of Pence next Sunday, 3:30 p.m. on the front lawn. I think Father Mark is kind of like the new priest gets to share in that joy. So he'll be out there blessing the Pence at 3:30. Because you never know what you're going to get. It's like a box of chocolates. And lastly, the big happening this weekend is our annual volunteer sign-up fair in Marion Hall. Matter of fact, I think they opened the door, so you can probably smell in the back of the church the popcorn that's going to be wafting along as you move in that direction to pull you into that ministry, like the calling of the Lord. So stop by and check out the many opportunities to serve in our very active parish that we have. Also, service projects and community events, information about all these things can be found in there, as well finding more about our adult and youth formation, family and Christian service ministries, which we have many, worship and music ministries, which is always a highlight of our liturgy here at St. Joe's, the Adoration Chapel, very special ministry that we have here at the parish. Representatives are available to assist you and answer any of your questions, and our representatives at our faith formation table are especially eager to welcome volunteers for our children's religious education classes. They will be on Monday and Tuesday evenings, starting, I think, that second week of October, so a couple weeks from now. And then also, you'll find in the gathering space, right by the welcome desk, there's a basket. We have a seminarian from the parish in there, and he's kind of requested participation. I guess he got tagged to be one of the spokesperson. So they're collecting candy so that they can do a Halloween event at the seminary. It's kind of a neighborhood that his beautiful historic neighborhood right there along the front row of the seminary, but some of the other neighborhoods are a little bit more distressed, and so it's nice to have a good, safe place to go for a Halloween event. They dress up as heroes, generally. They always try to be positive as they intermingle with the community around them down at Sacred Heart Major Seminary. So that's what that basket is for, with that candies. And finally, we do have a blessing and introduce to the community for Charlie and Patricia, Pat Warwick. So if they could please stand up, and a big round of applause for their 25th wedding anniversary. Yes. And joining them today, their lovely daughter, Gabriella. So go ahead and stand up to join us with the blessing. Thank you. Also an altar server. And then family and friends, muchas amigas. The wedding was in Torreon, Mexico, 25 years, 1999, an important year that they would have had. Beautiful weather, but it's kind of the edge of a desert, so it was a little bit hot that day. So it's a little bit cooler in Michigan in the end of September. So if I could invite the friends, the family, los amigos mejores para parar, and también unirse en esta bendición, to join in this wonderful blessing. And for the rest of the community, to kind of lift a hand of blessing over Charlie and Pat as I pray this blessing over them. Get this off here. There we go. Lord our God and Creator, we bless and praise your name. In the beginning, you made man and woman so that they might enter a communion of life and love. You likewise blessed the union of Charles and Patty so that they might reflect the union of Christ with his church. Look with kindness unto them today as they celebrate their 25th wedding anniversary. Amid the joys and struggles of their life, they have preserved the union between them. Renew their marriage covenant, O Lord. Increase your love in them and strengthen their bond of peace. So surrounded by their daughter and family and friends, they may always rejoice in the gift of your blessing. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. God's blessing be upon you, the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Once again, a big round of applause for 25th anniversary. Now let us all rise to receive God's blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God's blessing be upon you all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen. The Mass is ended. Go out glorifying the Lord by your lives.
Thanks be to God.